We've had a really nice weekend in Sri Lanka, especially with regards to the ministry that we have been involved in. But at least for me, I must say, the thing that I've enjoyed most is your food. Yeah, I've really enjoyed eating. Wherever you go, however small, however big, the food is always tasty in Sri Lanka. So thank you so much for that. So the text that I've picked out for us today is from John chapter 9. I have a feeling you might be familiar with this text. It's about a blind man who has been born blind, and he has his only identity is that he is cursed. He meets Jesus along the way. Jesus heals him, and there are several other things that happen. We will sort of break that down, and then eventually he arrives at a wonderful understanding of who Jesus is. I'm not sure how many of us understand what it means to be cursed. We no longer use language like that. When I was growing up, I would have my uncle who would curse me, yeah. Like he would use something and say a curse. Now, that would deeply affect me. I would go back to my mom and say, how dare your brother curses me? And I would get angry. But these days, uncles are not that bad. They don't curse one another that often. So how do we understand what it means to be cursed? Some time ago, I was introduced to this DJ. Yeah, his name is Avicii. I'm not sure if you've heard of this personality. Avicii, a very prominent DJ, and the surprising thing about him is that he produced a lot of good songs, unlike some other DJs. Songs with sometimes good meaning. And so one of my students said, because I hated that kind of music, he said, no, but Mr. Tejas, you have to listen to Avicii. So I started listening to Avicii, and I was quite happy about what I heard. So there's this one song in which Avicii is sort of telling us a story about two girls who can't find meaning in their village. They find that the people in their village are very judgmental, are not very friendly, don't look at these two girls as very fond, and so they want to leave this village and move somewhere else because they can't find meaning among these villagers. And so they move to the city. And in the city, they happen to, this is a city with a lot of bright lights, and so they're drawn to enter into a party. And so they get into this party, and the music is pumping, and they look at all of these people jumping around and enjoying the music. And so they join in, they jump around and enjoy the music, and then they begin to think, oh yeah, I'm finding meaning in this party. Why should I live in this village? And so they leave the village, and they move into this party, and they're having a good time. And guess who's the DJ at this party? It's Avicii. He is the center of this party. But the irony of this story is, while Avicii in this song has given meaning to these two girls, he himself hasn't found meaning. And his life ended very tragically. He committed suicide. I think he was just 29 or 32, I'm not sure exactly. He committed suicide. And then his parents were asked, how come Avicii, such a successful DJ, such a wealthy man who has traveled all over the world, has fans all over the world, how come he has committed suicide? And then they said, Avicii couldn't find happiness in his life. He wasn't able to handle his fame, wasn't able to handle his wealth. He felt cornered from all directions, and hence he committed suicide. So maybe for our generation, that's what it means to feel cursed, to be cornered from all directions, and not see a way out of the situation you are in. Maybe there are a few people here who are sitting feeling like that, feeling cornered from all directions and not seeing a way out. Or maybe you know people who seem to be cornered from all directions and see no way out. Now, that's exactly how this blind man might be feeling. But what is the disciples' opinion of this? So the first question they ask Jesus is this man blind because of his sin or because of his parents' sin? That's a very unhelpful statement. We often ask that. When someone is suffering, are they suffering because of what they have done? So in some sense, we are trying to say the suffering is justified because of the kind of decisions and the life that they have lived previously. So they are justified in suffering. And so that's a very unhelpful question. Then you can also sense some sense of helplessness in this blind man and his family. Here is a guy who's born blind. He doesn't know why he's born blind. He's beginning to think maybe he's done something wrong, his parents have done something wrong. And then in our situation, in our culture, it's very, very common if you have someone like that in your family, everyone in the village and town would sort of look at you very differently. Yeah, don't have anything to do with this family. So you can also imagine if he had siblings, no one would want to marry those siblings because they would say, whatever it is, don't marry people from this family because they are a cursed family. Don't have anything to do with them. So you can sense helplessness not only in this blind man, helplessness in his parents, helplessness also if he had siblings in them. Don't have anything to do with them. Now, this is a very sorry state of affairs for any one of us to be in. But then you have a third opinion. The first opinion was unhelpful, which is these people are suffering, maybe because of what they have done, and we leave them at that. Then the second opinion is a sense of helplessness. We don't know what to do. Why is this happening to us? Why is this happening to my family alone? The third opinion is a hopeful opinion. That's when Jesus enters the scene. And to some extent, Jesus says something very interesting, though it's not written in the Bible, but it amounts to that. He says, rubbish. He is not blind because of his parents' sin. He is not blind because of his own sins. But interestingly, Jesus says three things, which is very interesting for him to say on the Sabbath. He says three things. Now, very often when we are suffering or when others suffer, the question that we ask is, why is this happening to me? Why is this happening to them? But that's, like we just found out, is a very unhelpful question. Instead, start asking, what? What can be done? And that's what we find Jesus doing here very interestingly. He doesn't ask these why questions. Instead, he has moved his disciples from stopping them from asking why to start looking at a solution, which is what can be done. And so in your situations, whatever it is that you're going through, stop asking why, start asking what. What can be done? And when you look at people around you, and if you see them suffering, stop asking why, start asking what. Now we'll see what Jesus does here. He does three very interesting things in this text. He starts off by saying, he is blind because the works of God are going to be displayed on him. Just imagine the burden that this man has from all along, all over his journey as a young man to be called cursed. And then suddenly here is a man like Jesus, a man of Jesus' stature saying, he is blind because my work is going to be displayed on him. Even if he doesn't see after this, even if he still remains blind, you can imagine the relief that he is experiencing now. I'm no longer cursed, but God is going to display his work on me. The second thing that Jesus says here is, work the works of God. Now that's a command to one of us. Okay, so let's say people are suffering around you. He says, I'm going to do my work in their lives, but in the meanwhile, you go out and do my work. So here Jesus is involving us in his work. Then the third thing Jesus says here is a warning. Very interestingly, work while it's day because night is coming soon. That's a sense of urgency. Don't be lethargic in your Christianity. Don't be lethargic because this why question is a lethargic question. There is no hope in asking these why questions. So don't be lethargic. And interestingly, Jesus has used the word work thrice on a Sabbath day. It's a Sabbath day, and he has used the word works. So in your life, if you are going through a difficult time, wait. God is going to display his work in your life. But in the meanwhile, you and I who are sitting here can become agents of God's work. You go out. Where is God when people are suffering? He is in each one of you to go out and become agents of God's love. And work quickly because night is coming soon. So that's, if you are into literature, that's Act 1, Scene 1. So Act 1, Scene 1 now has ended. It began with a very hopeless situation, asking unhelpful questions, and then Jesus enters with a lot of hope. Act 1, Scene 1 ends here. Act 1, Scene 2 begins now. So you would imagine this blind man now, he can see, he goes back to his village. You would imagine these people to share in his joy. I can see. So in the meanwhile, Jesus has healed this man in a very peculiar way. So he goes back to his village, hoping that his villagers would also be excited about his sight as much as he is excited. But that's not the case. The moment he enters in, people are very disappointed that he has been healed. Do we feel like that sometimes? When something good happens in someone else's life, we feel disappointed. It happens on Facebook all of the time. Yeah? We sometimes just simply press like. But actually, we are very sad that they're having a good time in life. So when someone's having a good time, sometimes we don't want them to have a good time. More so, if they happen to be people we don't like. People who we don't want to have a good time, they're having a good time. How? This isn't fair. So that's how the villagers react to this man. They don't want him to see. And so they ask him questions like, are you really this man? And interestingly, in the Bible passage, this man doesn't have a name. His only identity is that he is cursed. That's his only identity. No name, a nameless cursed man. So they ask him questions like, are you really this man who was blind and now that you can see? And so he says, that's me. I am the man who was blind, but now I see. Now another thing that these villagers might have felt is all along they might have told their children, don't do this because if you do this, you will end up like this. So now they've lost a good example as well. Yeah. So here, if you do this, you will end up like this blind man. Or if you do this, you will end up like this family. So a good example is lost for them. So they're very disappointed with him. So they ask him, how come you see now? And so very interestingly, he says, I was blind, but the man, Jesus, healed me. Very interesting. I was blind, but the man, Jesus, heals me. He considers Jesus just as a man. But what sort of a man was Jesus? The man, Jesus, healed me. Now, if you look at Jesus' life, he was a very compassionate man, very forgiving. He was a very just man. What is justice for Jesus? Forgiveness. That's how he viewed justice. The woman caught in adultery. What does he say? What is his form of justice? Don't cast stones on her. Instead, go and sin no more. For Jesus, justice is forgiveness. He was very focused. He knew what he wanted and he knew how to get it. There's a scene at one point where they've taken Jesus to the edge of a cliff and they want to throw stones and get rid of him. But Jesus is so determined that he moves away from that. He disappears is what the text says. He was so focused, he knew what he wanted. Eventually he would die the same way, but that was not the time for it to happen. Then he was a very well-balanced man. Yeah, he walked around, he was with many people, he handled people very well. He had women along with him, but yet he did not abuse them. We don't have any story of Jesus, either from the Bible or extra-biblical sources, that say Jesus abused or mistreated women. He was really a good man. Probably he's a great model for all of us men who are sitting here. He might have been the father that every child would have wanted to have in their lives. He might have been the husband that every woman would have wanted to marry. And so I think this man saw Jesus, this blind man saw Jesus as a man, and I think he's a good example for every man who is sitting here to emulate their lives after the way Jesus lived his life. So that's the first interview that this blind man comes, and he identifies Jesus as a good man, and it's a good thing for us to see Jesus as a good man, a good example for us to follow. Then they are not very happy with him, so they say, okay, come, let's take you to the Pharisees. Yeah, the Pharisees are the religious bigwigs of that time. And so they drag him to the Pharisees. And interestingly, here, he meets the Pharisees, and they also are very curious to find out, how is it that you are able to see? And very interestingly, in this passage, if you look at your Bibles, his testimony has become shorter. He very simply says, in verse 15, he put mud on my eyes and I washed and I see. He put mud on my eyes and I washed and I see. But his understanding of Jesus has improved. If you move to verse 17 of John chapter 9, he says he is a prophet. He starts off by thinking that Jesus is a man. I was blind, but now I see. The man Jesus healed me. But now he says his testimony has become shorter, but his understanding of Jesus has grown. Sometimes in our journey, our testimonies become bigger. We add a lot of masala to it. We make our testimony slightly more grander than what it really is. Yeah. So the testimony sometimes goes like this. I was a rowdy. I used to kill people. I murdered people. I was a womanizer. and then I met Jesus. And since then, my life has gone downhill. Yeah, it's something like that. Yeah, so our testimony becomes bigger, but Jesus becomes smaller. And every time we share our testimony seems to be adding a lot of stories that didn't have the previous time, but our understanding of Jesus has remained the same. Whereas this young blind man, his understanding of Jesus has improved. From him seeing Jesus merely as a man, now he's beginning to think he is not just merely a man, albeit he was a good man, but he cannot be just a man, he is a prophet. His understanding of Jesus has grown. So at this point, what the Pharisees think is, okay, we're fed up of listening to his testimony, let's bring his parents in. And so they bring his parents in. Now, this is a very interesting part of the passage. It's a very confusing part of the passage, at least for me. So here are these people who have all along been seen as cursed, and then something phenomenal has happened in their life. Their son can see. And now they've been brought into this meeting to meet these Pharisees. And very interesting thing happens here. One is they disassociate themselves with this son. They say, okay, yeah, he's my son, but we don't want to have anything to do with what has happened now. Now, a couple of things come to our mind. Are they being ungrateful? Here is something beautiful that has happened to them. Why are they not willing to share this story with everyone? So that was one question that I had. Here is something phenomenal that has happened. All along, they have been cursed, seen as a cursed family in their village. No one would have wanted to do anything to do with them. But then now suddenly their son can see the curse has been removed, and yet they don't seem very excited about it. They don't want to talk about it as much as their son is. Now, initially, my response was very judgmental. Yeah? I thought, what sort of a family is this? Here is something good has happened, and instead of testifying, they're holding back and saying, all that we know is our son was blind, but apart from that, we don't have anything to do with his story. Now, this is a classic case of people who suffer for the gospel. Now, in India, it's a very common thing where people suffer for the gospel. I'm sure it also happens here. There are stories where people were driven out of their villages into forests, where they were chased, fighting for life, ran into a forest, despite losing many of their family members, survived in the forest. But then some of them were asked to come back into the village, and they were forced to reconvert. And some of them actually did reconvert. But then they ran back into the forest and became Christians again. Then there are stories of people, Christians who have been traveling by bus. There's a very interesting story of a lady called Sister Maria. She was traveling by bus from one village to the other village. A man entered in with a knife in his hand. But before he showed the knife, he brought sweets out. And he gave sweets to everyone in the bus, except to this lady. And she asked, why are you giving everyone these sweets except to me? So he said, okay, anyway, I'll give it to you as well. But this will be the last sweet that you're going to eat. And so he took the sweet. So she took the sweet, ate it, and then he stabbed her to death. He stabbed her approximately 36 times, took her out of the bus, threw her into the forest, and left her dying there. And no one knew where she was for a couple of days. And she was dying by herself alone because she was a Christian. Just because she was a Christian. So across the world, people are suffering just to bear the name of Christ. But this story doesn't end like that. So her sister somehow finds her 2 days later and recovers her body and gives her a proper burial. But the interesting part of the story is they find the man who killed the sister and he's put in prison. But then this lady's sister, decides to go meet this man, but he doesn't want to meet them. He says, I don't want to have anything to do with you. I feel terribly guilty for what I've done. But they say, no, we want to come and meet you. And so as a family, they go, and the first thing that the mother of this lady does is go and kiss the hands of the man who murdered her daughter. And everyone is surprised. And she says, the blood of my daughter's hand is on you. You are the last person to have touched her, and so I want to kiss it. I lost a daughter, but I have found a son. And that transformed his life drastically. He became a Christian after that experience, and he's now out of jail, and he lives very close to to them. So people all around the world suffer for the sake of the gospel. And so you here you find these people also, to some extent, experiencing suffering for the sake of the gospel. But the story doesn't end that sad here. There is a happy ending to the story. So here we have the second interview. The Pharisees are interviewing this guy. They're asking him all sorts of questions. And now you should imagine this guy. He was the guy who was bullied in his village. He had no confidence because the only thing that he was known was that he was cursed. But suddenly after meeting Jesus, his confidence level has gone up. He met Jesus just for a few minutes, yet his life has been transformed drastically. So look at the audacity with which he responds to some of the questions that the Pharisees have. So the Pharisees are constantly asking him these questions, and then he stops them and asks, "Why are you asking me so many questions? Do you also want to believe in Jesus?" Yeah, what audacity, yeah? This guy has just a few minutes with Jesus, and here he is talking to the Pharisees, the big wigs, the big people of his town, and saying, Do you also want to believe Jesus? This is like reverse ragging. Yeah, so these guys are ragging him. Now he's like, I'm going to rag you. But then what they do is very interesting. And then he goes on to say, like in the short while he has done his study, he says, in the history of the world, there has been no one who has healed a man who has been born blind. In verse 32, never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man born blind. Look at this guy's homework. By a merely blind man, just a few minutes with Jesus, and he has understood Jesus more than the Pharisees have understood what he is. And he says, and they ask him, who do you think he is? And he says, he must be a prophet. Indeed, he is a prophet, because no man has made a person who has been born blind able to see again. He is a prophet like Moses. Now, Moses offered quail and manna. What did Jesus offer? Jesus offered fish and bread. Moses offered the Ten Commandments from a mountain. Jesus offered the Sermon on the Mount from another mountain. So Jesus is a prophet, at least for them now. So he understands Jesus to be a prophet. In Matthew 21, verse 11, Jesus is referred to as a prophet from Nazareth. In Matthew 21, verse 46, the priests are aware and people think that he is a prophet. In John chapter 4, verse 19, a Samaritan woman says he must be a prophet. In John chapter 16, verse 14, 7, verse 40, looking at his actions and the things that he is doing, people say he must be a prophet. So here's a blind man, started off his journey thinking that Jesus is merely a man, but now he has come to an understanding that this man cannot merely be a man. He must be a prophet, because no one has healed a man born blind since birth. So he's come to this understanding that he is a prophet. Now once he says that, the Pharisees are wild. And so what do they say? You might be able to see, but you are still cursed. Get out of here. So here is a guy who has built his confidence. Just imagine a guy who has left your village or your school, who was the dull head. Everyone thought nothing much can amount from this guy. He goes out, he becomes the CEO of Google, and then he comes back into your village, and then there's a little boy in the village who sees him coming and then screams out and runs everyone and says, oh, that idiot has come back. You can imagine the pride with which he entered, and now when he's referred to as the idiot of his village again, being made to feel small and little again. Maybe at this point, he might have felt, I was better off blind than being able to see. Something good has happened to me, but everyone around me don't seem to resonate with the same feeling. They all would prefer me to be blind and cursed. Maybe at that point, he felt, it's better off that I am blind. Better off, my life before meeting Jesus was better off. And so he leaves this place feeling small and reminded of his state of being a cursed man. So again, Jesus enters the scene much like Rajinikanth. But very unlike Rajinikanth, what Rajinikanth might have done is he might have walked across this guy and he might have put an end to the Pharisaic race. Yeah, Rajinikanth would have gone, killed all the Pharisees, and he would have made the town free from the Pharisee parasite. But Jesus is not like Rajinikanth. We are thankful for that. So Jesus meets this blind man. And Jesus meets him at a point of his need. Now, there could be several questions that this blind man could have asked. Where was Jesus when I was being bullied? Where was Jesus when I was being made to feel small again? Where was Jesus when my family was being bullied? He could have had all of these questions. Maybe you and I right now might be having those questions. Where is Jesus in my situation now? Where is Jesus in the situation where my friends are, in the situations that my friends are going through or my relatives are going through? Where is Jesus? All I can say is I don't know. Where is Jesus? Where was Jesus when this was happening? But the good thing, the good news is Jesus comes. He comes. So whatever it is that you're facing, He comes. He will come. He might not come according to our timing, but He comes. He comes when it is the right time. And when He shows up, everything changes. The whole dynamic of the situation changes. Everything around you changes. Your whole personality, your whole understanding of the situation also changes. So I want to encourage you, wait for Jesus to show up. But the interesting thing that Jesus does here is we've moved into Act 1, Scene 3, very subtly. Now, Jesus does something which is very, which isn't very peculiar to his nature. So here is a guy who has been answering questions constantly, and he meets Jesus, and now Jesus asks him questions. He has had enough of answering questions, but now Jesus starts asking him a new set of questions. And the question that he asks him is also a very peculiar question, a question that you and I would not ask a man who has been bullied. He asks him a very peculiar question. Do you want to believe in the Son of Man? So what Jesus should have done is embraced him, patted him, and say, oh, I understand the struggles that you've gone through. Come, sit with me, put your head on my shoulder, let me calm you down. None of that. Yeah, Jesus doesn't seem to do anything of that. The first thing that he seems to ask him is a question, do you want to believe in the Son of Man? There is no relationship with what he has gone through and this question that is being asked. Because Jesus, one is because he is God. The other thing is, he is not satisfied with just our physical healing, but he wants to transition us from physical healing to spiritual healing. He is more interested in our spiritual growth. So he's transitioning this man from merely a physical healing to spiritual healing. So a very unrelated question. Do you believe in the Son of Man? And immediately this man doesn't say, Jesus, what sort of a silly question are you asking me? Here I am, I've been bullied and sent out of this place and you're asking me this question. He answers. Immediately he says, who is he? I want to believe. Look at this enthusiasm. Who is he? I want to believe. So here is a man who is not interested in the gifts that Thomas rightly said that Jesus gives. He wants Jesus himself. Jesus is the gift. It's not the gift that Jesus gives, but he himself becomes the gift. So the enthusiasm, who is he? I want to believe him. And Jesus very simply responds, you have seen him, it is he you are speaking to. So here's a transition from physical sight to spiritual sight. From a man who started off by thinking that this person, Jesus, was merely a man, he has moved to understanding him as a prophet, and now he is on the verge of declaring that Jesus is God. And how does he do that? Jesus says, I am the Son of Man, and then he responds by saying, Lord, I believe. It's very interesting. The usage of the word Son of Man is first used in Daniel chapter 7, verse 30, that signifies the Messiah. But what does it mean to be God? Why is Jesus not merely a prophet? How come he has moved from him thinking of him as a prophet, now beginning to think of him as God? For that, I want to quickly ask you to look into your Bibles and look at Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 10. So this is Joshua talking about Moses. And this is what he says. And there has not arisen a prophet since in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. So here is Joshua saying, there is no prophet who has ever come like Moses, because no one has seen God face to face. But how come this blind man begins to think that he's not merely a prophet, but something more than a prophet? For that, we would have to go to Exodus chapter 33, verse 20. Exodus chapter 33, verse 20, we have Moses here declaring a conversation between God and him. And this is what he said. This is what God says. But he said, "You cannot see my face, for man shall not see me and live." So Joshua is saying, Moses, there was no one since Moses who has seen God face to face. But Moses is saying, I cannot see God. So God is saying, you cannot see me face to face. All that you can see is my glory. But seeing God's glory itself is almost tantamount to seeing God's face. So that was what Moses is saying. So I cannot see God's face face to face, but I saw his glory, but yet it is tantamount to seeing God face to face. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 15. Another passage. And this is what Moses is saying. Yet, slightly different from what Joshua is saying, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is him you shall listen. So Joshua is saying there is no prophet who has seen God face to face. God is saying you cannot see me face to face, but you can see my glory. And everyone says seeing God's glory itself is tantamount to seeing God face to face. Moses is saying someone greater than me or like me will come after me. Now, I would like you to turn to John chapter 1, verse 18. Here is Jesus declaring something about himself. He says, no one has ever seen God. So that resonates with what God is telling Moses. You cannot see me and live. No one who has ever seen God can live. So he says, no one has ever seen God. The only God, very interesting, Jesus is referring to himself here as God, the only God who is at the Father's side, he has made him known. So here Jesus is declaring to this blind man that he is God. He's not merely a prophet, because Moses himself hasn't seen God face to face. He has only seen God's glory. But here is Jesus who has seen God face to face, and he is declaring to everyone the only God to himself was by the Father's side, and he has made him known. So here Jesus helps a blind man complete that journey completely. So we have that task also, to help others complete their journey. How are you going to do that? How are you going to help the people you meet every day complete that journey? To meet Jesus and recognize that he is not merely a man, but that he's also not just merely a man, he is a prophet. But again, not merely a prophet. He's someone greater than a prophet. He is God. Now that becomes each one of our tasks. As I started off earlier, God will reveal himself. He will do his glory. He will perform a glorious thing on your life or on people's lives around you. But in the meanwhile, we have to go do God's work. That has become our task. Now that has happened in the Bible. You see Philip and you see this eunuch. The eunuch is reading Isaiah on a chariot. I don't think any of us would want to do that. Yeah, even though we are Christians, reading the Bible even in a car can make you feel sick. But here is a guy reading the Bible in a chariot. And those days roads were not paved. A rocky ride, and he is reflecting on Isaiah. He's seeking God. There are people like that around you who are sincerely seeking God, who are honestly like the rich young man seeking God, or like this eunuch who is seeking God. And what does Jesus do? He sends Philip. And so he sends each one of us out into the world to share the gospel. And what does Philip do? He completes the journey of the eunuch. So you and I here have been called to complete the journey of people who are truly seeking God. Why do we do that? Because Jesus himself in this passage has done that. He goes out of his way to meet this blind man to help him complete that journey. So it becomes our task as well to complete that journey. So if you are here sitting, suffering, wondering, I want to remind you that Jesus will turn up. And he will celebrate on your suffering. What a thought. I think Christianity is the only religion that gives us that offer. He will celebrate on your suffering. Just imagine the cross, the bloody, dirty cross. A symbol of shame, a symbol of something that's really cheap. But now when you look at the cross, it has become a fashion symbol. That's what Jesus can do to our pain. That's what Jesus can do to our suffering. That's what Jesus can do to our crumbled lives. He can turn it into something which is beautiful. He will display his glory on your life at his time. In the meanwhile, you and I who are sitting here, we become God's hands and feet. He has invited us to participate in his nature. What a great honor for us as Christians. Not just to sit back and watch God enjoy himself, but here he's saying, I invite you to participate in my nature. You go out and do my work. You become my hands and feet. What a great opportunity for us as Christians. And then eventually, a challenge for each one of us here is, has your understanding of Jesus grown? Or are you still thinking of him as merely a man, merely a prophet, and still haven't fully understood him as God? If people here, if you're sitting here, today is your chance to understand that he's not merely a man, he's not merely a prophet, but that he is God. Thank you.